Let's go, buddy. It's time for the morning walk.
Give you a little scale there. You could drive your Tesla on a toadstool or a mushroom.
Yeah, this one, Don says, is the side of a dinner plate, at least a lunch plate.
Yeah.
It's 8 inches across there.
Yeah, it's big.
Yeah. The main road's dry.
Yeah.
The driveway is still working on it.
Yeah,
we're still cheating. Yeah. So Don and I have been following all of Eric Strait's or the Derek Tesla inventory channels solar panel installation this week, and I am basically salivating over these power walls being on the wall of their garage. It is awesome.
They're signed by Elon, Franz, and JB.
Yeah.
That's what she's salivating. And they're red.
And they're red. Yeah, these boys are creating a problem for Dawn because I want solar and a power wall in my garage next to where Ruby parks.
Yeah, and all we've got is trees, 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 trees.
But I'm not giving up. I'm not giving up.
No. Well, we're going to wait when we've filled out the little form that you do through the referral program. They basically say, you know, congratulations, you've got a power wall. So
thank you, by the way.
Yes, thank you, viewers. So I filled that out a couple months ago, 3 months ago. It's been a while, and I haven't heard anything yet. So basically they get up, they call you back and talk to you, you know, somebody comes out. Anyway,
Don's in trouble.
I'm
going to be going, Donnie.
A power wall using electricity arbitrage. I don't know if it's really worth it. We'll talk to the person because I don't think it covers the installation. So, and it can be kind of pricey, you know. The dubious payback. And of course, you know, Marianne likes it because it's signed by Elon. You know?
Well, I like it because it's the Tesla power wall on the wall of my garage.
Right, yeah. That's right.
I want to honestly be able to say to those people that are haters, our car's charged by solar.
That's right.
So if we could just have enough solar to charge the car, I'd be happy. We don't have to cover the whole house or anyway. Poor Donnie, he's not going to get off on this one too easy. Or he's going to have to watch his girl pout, and he doesn't do too well with pouting.
She pouts really long time.
So on the Facebook groups, particularly the Tesla Divas Facebook group, which I am a member of and love, lots of the girls are getting their high-powered wall chargers delivered. As you know, we won two of those.
Yes.
We took that instead of the kitty car referral.
Yes, thank you.
Are still waiting, and I know folks want to hear about it when we get it, and we will. Apparently, it comes up in a black box, and you kind of know what it is, so I told Don if the FedEx guy or UPS guy comes in the driveway and they're getting out, walking to the house with the black box, that's the wall chargers. Should be two of them. I told him also that I really thought that Tesla has a real opportunity with all the referral people to not deliver the high-powered wall chargers, and if they've also won the Powerwall, until they can come out and talk to them about installation and, you know, try to push solar a little bit there. It's an business opportunity.
Yep.
So we'll see, but we are waiting. Hi, Mittens. We love you, sweetheart.
We have a solar unfriendly house, so you know, that's really the issue. It's not. I mean, if we didn't have all the trees, we'd have solar. We'd have had it before now because North Carolina getting solar.
There was an incentive for quite some time to really help out.
Well, there was a little bit. It's complicated. The types of basically sign up and get solar on your roof, and you know, the lease payment or the payments built in over the 20, you don't have to put any money up front. Those types of contracts were not legal in North Carolina. They have just changed some of the rulings, the Public Utilities Commission, back like last October, and I haven't actually read any really good detail on it. I haven't checked into it, but prior to October, those types of sign and power deals that a lot of states like California had, you couldn't get those in North Carolina. The only way you could basically did it, you had to go out and get a loan and buy the panels outright, or you know, just pay cash for them is basically the only way you could get panels legally on your roof in North Carolina. So now there are three different programs that is available. And one of them, which is another one I was thinking about, and we're checking into it because of our situation, it's kind of like community solar.
Right.
Where you choose to pay some money or pay more on your bill or something, and basically Duke puts in a solar panels on someplace where it's easy to put solar panels. I don't understand all the details, but
so you could be helping fund solar but not on your property.
Right, you could still have solar. I don't know what kind of advantage you get other than the saying that, you know, you're sponsoring solar energy. I mean, that's a positive thing. I don't know that you get any tax, you know, that 30% federal tax credit. I don't know if you get any of that on the money. I'm sure Duke keeps that too. You know, North Carolina, the solar is, I'm not trying to be really negative, but the solar is 100% facilitated and driven by whatever Duke wants, whatever money more money they can make. The one thing they don't want to hear is anybody trying to go off grid. They are absolutely totally opposed to that.
Well, I guess we're the third largest producer of solar power in the country, but right. It's not home solar.
Not rooftop.
It's these big fields owned by the electric companies.
That's right. Yeah. Well, leased by the electric companies. That's right.
Yeah. So, and looking for something to do for part of the day today, I picked the Cape Fear Museum. It's a Civil War historic site with a legitimate museum and then a historical house to tour. It's 52 minutes and about 40 miles away for us, so just a short little hop down near Fayetteville. So on top of having a Civil War exhibit inside the Cape Fear Museum, there's also a Poe house on the property, which I was interested in touring, and it is the house of coincidentally named Edgar Allan Poe, not related, who was a prominent Fayetteville businessman. So we'll get to go inside that house. There's also a couple of monuments and things out on the grounds, and the museum looks like a pretty good good-sized museum. So we had the option of going 401 all the way down or taking 1 or 2 minutes longer and picking up 210 and then coming back over to 401. And we go 401 a lot, so we decided to get on 210. Because this is all about enjoying the pretty North Carolina day. Pleased to note that the watt hours per mile over the last, I guess it says since last charge is 295.
Yeah, it's below 300, and that's unusual for us.
In the summer, lately.
Right.
I've got the air on 73 up front, I think a fan motor of 3. That does make a little bit of difference.
Yes, 87 out there right now, so it's plenty warm.
As soon as we crossed into the Fayetteville city limits, we saw all the signs for Fort Bragg, home of the 82nd Airborne. Basically, they allow some of these public roads, but we're actually going through part of the land owned by the military base. Hills of North Carolina, where you'll find pines, and more pines. So Don's brought me into downtown Fayetteville. I wanted to look for some murals and local art before we went over to the museum, and this looks like the old courthouse in front of us here.
That's the marketplace. That thing with the clock is the market. This is the marketplace.
Okay. So it was not the old courthouse.
No, it's not the old courthouse. It's open air at the bottom.
Yeah. It's very, very pretty, architecturally speaking. Welcome to historic downtown Fayetteville.
there's a building over here on the right. What is this? This is the historic courthouse. Okay, well, I knew the courthouse had to be close to where we were.
Lafayette was born in Chavaillac, France.
Chavaniac.
Yeah, okay. On September 6, 1757, he left France in 1777 at age 19 to join the fight for the American freedom in the Revolutionary War. Lafayette was befriended by George Washington, wounded at Brandywine and given a command as a major general. He influenced the monarchy in France to ally with America and to send the French expeditionary force to battle the British. Lafayette commanded the Continental Army in the Virginia Campaign and was instrumental in the defeat of the British General Cornwallis and the victory at Yorktown. He is one of only seven foreigners to be awarded honorary United States citizenship.
Lafayette continued to fight for the government by the people during the French Revolution and was imprisoned from 1792 to 1797 by anti-revolutionary European monarchs. Throughout his life, he remained a steadfast advocate of human rights, including the abolition of slavery. In 1783, Fayetteville, North Carolina became the first city in the United States to be named for Lafayette. In 1825, Lafayette visited Fayetteville during his grand tour of the United States as the hero of the two worlds. Although scores of towns and countries in the United States have been named for him, Fayetteville is the only namesake city that Lafayette actually visited. So I spotted this historical marker as we drove past. We're actually at the Division of Highways Motor Vehicle. But it says Babe Ruth. He hit his first home run in professional baseball March 1914, 135 yards northwest of this location. In this town, George Herman Ruth acquired the name Babe. I had no clue. And I'm spinning all of these historical markers as Pokestops and Pokemon Go and collecting some great gifts to send to people from outside of my normal Fuquay. Well, we have made it to the Cape Fear Historical Complex, and this is Poe House.
Yeah, it didn't take very long at all for them. Yeah, they were working on this pretty quickly. That's quicker than most buildings take today, as I've noticed. Right. So. At this point, we can head on in if you want to follow me.
Okay, sweetie. I told you it was going to get
wet. Do not be alarmed. There is a tour in there that is starting to take over, so you'll just see people in there. Then let them in. We are going to go in this room here, so you guys can go in there. If you want to get the door behind me, yeah. Thank you. Okay, so this is the parlor. As a guest in a Victorian household, you only saw a few rooms throughout the house. That is the entryway, of course, when you walk in, this parlor, and then the dining room if you're invited over for dinner. Other than that, you can see any other part of the household, but Victorians just believe in two spheres of the household, public and private, and they like to keep it that way. Quite different from today, we like to share everyone all the rooms in our household, see how big all the bedrooms are and the bathrooms, and they didn't really do that. Although they did find other subtle ways to show off how much money they had, and you'll see that throughout the house. One of those ways was to have a large entryway. The bigger the entryway, the more money you must have. Because it's a big waste of space otherwise. So, maintaining some parlor, which is very important. It's very essential to a woman's respectable nature and her family to entertain other guests, to make sure that your family still looks very respectable. And that's just how they did it. So, a lot of work goes into making sure we don't disturb Mrs. Poe when she's entertaining. If you look on the wall back over there, that long blue one is another one done by Lily. Just something to look at. Also, that writing desk over there is original to the house. It's the same one that they use when they live there. If you were not in here when I explained the stereoscope, that's just kind of like a viewmaster. You look at the pictures. Yeah.
All snuggled in their bed.
Oh yeah. That's pretty cool.
Okay. So this is the master bedroom. Mr. and Mrs. Poe slept in here, and then eventually Lily when she got the house later on. That is Mrs. Poe's original sewing machine over there. It's the same one that she used to sew clothes for her kids on, so that's pretty cool. I can actually open up this armoire so you can see the inside of it. Anything you see in this house is from the years 1897 to 1917, so it's a good 20-year window. And that includes clothes and whatnot that you might see in here.
That's a gorgeous piece of furniture.
For example, so for your point of time.
Wow.
Okay. Over here you have a wash basin. You'll see one of these in every single room throughout the house. Because it's essential to living. It's sort of your sink without all of the plumbing attached to it. So take a guess about how many days a week they'd be taking a bath. Yeah,
maybe.
One day a week. Not only Saturday, because that's the day before church, so today, bath day. For the rest of the week, use this to keep yourself as clean as humanly possible. You know, wash your hands, face, give yourself a sponge bath if necessary, shave if you're a guy with it. A woman would not have shaved at the time because you were using a straight razor, and that's not exactly worth the effort. Not only that, but no one's going to see it anyway because you're covered head to toe and everything, so no worries.
This must be the children's bedroom.
So this is the nursery. Children up to the age of 7 would be in this room. Once they hit 7 years old, they could go upstairs with the older kids, but until then, they were down here. These are all the toys they would play with. We actually have Lily's diary, and she wrote one Christmas that she got paper dolls, and she was really, really happy about that. So we have paper dolls over there for her. You can see what they look like in case you aren't familiar with them. Over here we like to call the world's first easy bake oven.
Mm. Oh, it's adorable.
It's a little stove model, and what happens is when the guy going around town trying to sell stoves to the woman of the household, he would bring this with him, show her all the different models, she could pick which one she wanted, and then have the real one sent to her later on, because you're not going to bring a giant cast iron stove with you. That's just so inconvenient. So you have these, and this is heavy enough as it is.
Right.
It is made out of actual cast iron, so that's some heavy weight to it. This one did not belong to the Poes, but it did belong to two girls in the area at the same time as them. They made mud pies on it and things like that, so not much has changed in 100 years. It's a tiny stove a girl's going to want to play on.
This is the servants' stairs.
The fact that their staircase is even visible is quite impressive.
Right.
Wealthier households, you wouldn't even see it at all. It'd be behind the wall, and they'd have to open the door to get to it. So, eventually, Lily paid to have this one taken out. It's kind of silly to me to pay money to take out a staircase, but she did. Reason being, I think her brother came to live with her after a while, and his wife, and their room's like directly where the staircase led, so she wanted to give them more privacy. Personally, I would just put up a barrier or just not use it, but to each his own. Are there any questions about that? Have the door shut. The one on the left is a bridal suite when we have weddings on the premises. The other one is just storage, so nothing fancy. But do keep in mind, there have been two functional bedrooms that the children have slept in, and I can squeeze them all into these two rooms here. We just don't have it for show. This one here is set up for a girls' room, so you can call me this way.
You can see here the servant stairs that we just walked up, and the stairs for the residents. You can see both of them from this location. We're on the second floor now, which there is a huge open area here in the middle of the house between the four bedrooms, two on either side.
See how thick the fabric is. That's fine. It's a replica, so it's not original. You won't, you know, make it grubby or anything. This is, of course, just the outer layer. A woman will have several things underneath it, all of which are displayed on that chair there. The only differences are there are two bits on here that are not undergarments, and that's this, because this is a girl's dress. You can see how that looks. This is the front this way, and then the back is just hook and eye closures.
So as she explained, when the children were 7, they left the nursery and came upstairs to one of the four bedrooms upstairs, and this bedroom was set up as a girl's room. And I suspect the one we're moving to next is set up as a boy's room. And these were mostly undergarments here to go underneath the dress we viewed over here.
Otherwise, this house won't stay cool, and we have air conditioning, you can feel how hot it's in here. So this is a good example, but a boy at the time would have worn, fun fact about that, a boy would have worn shorts until his father said he was old enough to wear pants. That's actually where you get the expression, he wears the pants in the family from. It's only the adult men would wear pants. Generally, they'd be allowed to wear them around age 16, but wore them in shorts all year round. They would have stockings to keep their legs warm underneath so they don't die of hypothermia before they become a man. But otherwise, yeah. Still not exactly the best thing, I'm sure, but that's how it was. Behind you there in the armoire, we do have World War I uniforms. That's because one of the sons did actually serve during the war. He was drafted in July of 1918, and the armistice was signed November that same year, so he got sent right back, didn't see any combat, got very lucky. Over here, we have a little fun event. If you want to push down a little button here. Generally, it goes into the sack. Sometimes it will do that. Today, it wanted to go. Why is it coming to me?
Well, I didn't see it.
This is the room that the cook slept in.
That's the problem with having such tall ceilings, is that your heat is right.
No heat. So if she wanted to stay warm in the winter, she would have to spend more time in the kitchen. Yeah.
Whoa.
And my grandmother's house in New Jersey had front stairs and back stairs. It was very fun as a child to play hide and seek in that
we
house.
We didn't have two stories, we just had 10 rooms.
Oh wow.
Oh wow, yeah, really.
I want to have dinner here.
Yeah, this is my favorite room in the house. Some of those are just coming in.
This is where the butler would stage what he was serving to the guests.
Every meal together here, breakfast, lunch, and dinner. Little glass. This little one right here.
Finger bowl maybe? A little small?
That's a good guess, but no.
Butter?
Not butter, it is a food. Yeah, it's not liquid. You are so close. The purpose is there, but not the right food.
It's not.
It is a palate cleaner, but it's not. That's a good guess. It's actually almonds, and it's used, like she said, to cleanse the palate in between courses. So everyone has that. Oh, good. Let's go and get the other half of that.
Almonds,
yeah.
A knife rest, and salt.
Yeah. One more question. Who wants to take a guess as to what goes in this lovely jar here?
Hmm.
It's got tongs
requires tongs.
Not sugar. It is a food.
Is it banana balls?
No, but you're getting closer.
Balls of butter? Like they had made in.
Farther away.
Something.
It would, is
it
a
would it be for?
Little tomatoes.
Pickles?
Yes. Pickles.
Oh, pickle jar.
Fancy pickle jar. Yeah. I have had an actual couple in here literally arguing over the necessity of this pickle jar. It's got important to them. The wife really, really wanted one. The husband thought it was the most pointless thing he'd ever seen
Amen.
In his life. He was like, you don't need this. You have a fork, you take the jar, you get the pickle out, you're done. Oh, but it's so beautiful. They were arguing for like 5 minutes. It's hilarious. But yeah, that's really cool.
Butler's pantry door.
Yeah.
Donnie.
The dog walk? Breezeway? What is it? Dog walk?
No. And here's the kitchen. Separate from the house, of course. With a life-size stove.
Oh yeah. We need cookies and donut holes and things on it. So come back then if you want some free food. Just make sure to get here early because it goes very quickly, as you can imagine. So this is the only thing that is firewood. Like I said, the firewood goes in here and heats up the whole thing. This is where all, of course, your burners technically are. And then over here is for water. So if you want to boil some water, you put it over there. And then the middle is your oven. Now there is a temperature dial on that, but it's a relatively new idea and it's not going to work as great as ours would today. So a lot of cooking on this thing is complete and utter guesswork. You have to feel the heat, see how long it needs to be in there, test your food, you're constantly having to check on it. That's why you can't really leave your house if you have this thing cooking something, because it probably will burn down if it's left unattended. Nowadays you can probably just leave your oven preheated, step out for a minute, come back. It's not going to really burn down your house yet, unless you're completely careless, but you know. On here, we have a lovely picture. I won't pan this around so you guys can see it, but these are the two servants, Nancy and Jenny. Next to them is one of the daughters. And then there are chickens in this picture for anyone who wants to.
They do have weddings here, and there are some beautiful, very old southern magnolias here in the back side of the house. You can see the museum in front of me to the right and a storm cloud. We've been hearing thunder. This was the children's playhouse. There's actually a historical picture over here showing children playing in it. It's from 1918.
One of the Poe's grandchildren. So we're walking from the backyard of the Poe house across to Arsenal Park, which is where the arsenal was. All this land, well, there was a arsenal built by the U.S. government prior to the Civil War that was then burnt by Sherman during the Civil War. And we're going over, I forget what this is called, the All-American Expressway. This site's been open to the public for 30 years. Celebrating its 30th year.
The Northwest Tower was the first of the arsenal's four towers to be built, 1839 to 1840, and initially served as the facility's temporary office. The three-story octagonal towers protruded beyond the corners of the main compound and were a defensive feature that allowed flanking fire along the exterior wall. The Ghost Tower, this structure in front of us, is a semblance of the original brick tower and enables visitors to understand the scale of these structures.
You can see the original foundation, the ghost structure, is basically
on top of the original foundation.
So that's roughly, so it's, you're looking at basically what it looked like.
And as they had told us, they are currently doing an archaeological dig over here. They were here earlier today, uncovering part of the foundation of one of the buildings and I guess looking for artifacts. This says Engine House, 1838 to 1848. The Engine House received its first engine in 1859 and served as the power source for the Smith and Gun carriage shops. And you can see here the foundation of several buildings. Still over here in Arsenal Park. Southwest Tower. This was the last of the four arsenal towers to be built. In the original plans, this tower was to be the guard and prison rooms. And you can see they have a nice amount of foundation left for this one.
So this arsenal was originally constructed after the War of 1812. Basically, at the time, the U.S. government decided that it needed better defensive capabilities. It was originally designed to both manufacture and store arms, but what happened was they couldn't get a railroad. So they, in the 1840s, they decided that it was going to be changed to a deposit only. In other words, they were just going to hold arms here, but it was turned back into a fully functioning, Congress voted money to expand it. So they expanded the buildings, but they never put the machinery to manufacture arms back in it during the 1850s. The Civil War was the early 1860s at Harper Ferry, which is up in Maryland, Pennsylvania type area. They took all, the Confederates took all that and brought all that machinery down here, and they actually manufactured approximately 10,000 rifles. They called them Fayetteville rifles. But mostly what this site made during the Civil War was ammunition, bullets. That's what, it made millions of bullets.
And Don said that we only have half the site left. The highway took half of it. That decision was made in the 60s. He said they preserved the part that was had the most foundations and artifacts left and took the part that wasn't in such good condition.
Right.
This is a boat the Indians made out of a tree, and it is very similar to the one in the History Museum in downtown Raleigh. I guess this one was found in Gray's Creek and then very carefully moved here. So this Burmese python came back from Vietnam.
It was in downtown Raleigh at the Natural Sciences Museum from 64 to 89. There is a book called An Unlikely Refugee, The Story of a Python Named George. Drawings by Max Dowdle, the art. Master Sergeant Simpson is the one that brought the snake back, and he's the one that actually wrote the book. And this room is showing some of the pages from the book itself. So that's pretty cool. I have not heard of a guy from Vietnam bringing back a snake. Again. The market house that we drove past earlier and took pictures of, which is also depicted in this artwork here, is the site where North Carolina ratified the Constitution. The original building, which is depicted here, burned down and was replaced by the market house that you see here.
Yeah, the thing is that North Carolina established Raleigh was the first planned capital. They actually, you know, it was just an open field, and they went out there and said, we're going to build our capital here in Raleigh. And that was to solve a dilemma between the people who lived along the coast, the farmers, rich farmers, and the mountain people who didn't do such large farms. So there was a battle. So I forget why Fayetteville fell out of favor. I guess because it was under the control of the eastern farmers. This is as far as boats could navigate up the Cape Fear River. So that's how Raleigh came about, was to replace Fayetteville.
Oh wow, there's a simulation of a water wheel, a mill here. That's pretty cool. I suggest folks go to Yates Mill and see the real wheel. However, I really do like that they've put this exhibit in here. They have the stones and trying to show how they're actually doing the corn grinding. And Yates Mill does have this same machinery, and they do run it several times a year, at least once a month, I think, in good weather. So Yates Mill would love to have more visitors. So North Carolina, as we said before, big on growing cotton, and then big on producing textiles with the cotton. And this machine here apparently was used to make tube socks. I guess maybe the sock came out of that hole.
He would capture gun part from Harper's Ferry. That's what that other sign said.
Yeah, as Don was saying when we were outside before, that they made something called the Fayetteville Rifle at the armory. With the fall of the Federal Armory at Harper's Ferry in April 1861, equipment, machinery, and parts were shipped to Richmond and Fayetteville, accompanied by many of the arsenal workers. By 1862, the rifle factory at Fayetteville was in full production, although still dependent on some items from Richmond. The Fayetteville rifle was similar to the U.S. Model 1855 rifle and was a .58 caliber. Elements of the Fayetteville rifle changed during the war as workers adapted to shortages of materials. Lock plates became smaller, the shape of the hammer changed, and the saber baronet gave way to the socket baronet. You know the school groups that come here have to love this simulated boat. I guess this is more the cargo area than up on top. Cotton being carried, pottery. Pretty cool. They've done a nice job with the enjoyed our tour of the house, the arsenal grounds, and the museum. Great time. So what is this here by Ruby?
Just the corn marking the start of the arsenal. This tablet marks the site of an important arsenal of the Confederate government authorized by the United States Congress in 1836, captured by North Carolina April 22nd, 1861, transferred to the Confederacy government June 5th, 1861, and destroyed by Major General
W.T. Sherman.
March 11th,
through the 14th, 1865.
Oh, I'm sick now that it's raining on Ruby. Poor Donnie. We got 70% rain in the forecast several of the next upcoming days, so we really weren't going to be able to keep her dry, but I'm so sorry.
Yeah, we'll give her the bee up test. See how she bees.
Yeah, we wanted to show you how good she bees up for her. That's right. You got to make lemonade out of lemons.
Right at 102 miles today.